Happy Sunday, everyone. God is good all the time, all the time. God is good. I'm Lynne Hubley. I'm the interim pastor of the First Baptist Church in Sanbenton, New Hampshire, and I'm so glad to be with you this morning. I hope you're having a good day. I hope you had a good week. But if you are not and you did not, I just want to remind you that great is his faithfulness and his mercies are new every day. This is a new day. So let's pray together and then I'm going to share with you a message. Heavenly Father, thank you. This is the day that you have made and we will rejoice and be glad in it. And God, no matter what is going on in our circumstances, today we can declare that you are the God of everlasting. You are God, our creator. You are the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning. You're the end. You're the owner of a cattle on a thousand hills. Father, you are the good shepherd. You are our heavenly Father. And we have the privilege of being called children of God. We get to call you our Abba, our Daddy. And God, out of the great love that you had for us in sending your one and only Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for the forgiveness of our sins, when we repent, God, we can have that amazing relationship with you. And for that, we are truly grateful. God, I pray now that you would speak to each one of us. Thank you for your precious word. I pray that it would take deep root and that it would be a passage that we would marinate in and just ruminate and think about, not just today, but all week long, God, as our circumstances come and as we struggle with things, I pray that this passage would come to mind, and I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. The title of this morning's message is called Waiting is Not a Waste of Time, and we're going to be looking at a passage in Isaiah 40. But let me start with just a little illustration. It was a little boy who was fishing, and he was catching nothing. And a man came by, and he asked the boy, he said, "Are you fishing, boy?" And the little boy looked at him, and he said, "No, I'm not fishing." He said, "I'm just drowning worms." And I think maybe that's sometimes how it feels when we're waiting for something, right? It feels like, sometimes it just feels like a waste of time. It feels like we're not accomplishing anything. I know when you're a kid, waiting for Christmas or for a birthday can feel like forever. But even as adults, some of the things that we're waiting for can feel like we're waiting forever. You know, the single person who's just waiting to find a spouse, waiting to find someone to share their life with, the married couple who are struggling to have children and just waiting to be blessed with a child, a spouse who's waiting for a bad marriage to get better, waiting to find a job, waiting for a good night's sleep, waiting to feel better, waiting to be healed, waiting for a child or a grandchild or a family member or a friend to turn to the Lord, waiting for the vaccine, waiting to enjoy social gatherings again. I don't think it helps that we live in a microwave generation, society, if you will. Everything is instant. Instant messaging, paying bills online, ordering everything online and having it delivered. I think I saw a commercial about a guy that had ordered a car and the next day, voila, it was delivered. We get our news instantly. There's fast food. There's drive-through, everything. And what happens is people want everything and they want it right now. But sadly, this can spill over into our relationship with the Lord, specifically our expectations when it comes to God answering our prayer. See if you can relate to this. A pastor was pacing back and forth in his office, and one of the parishioners said, "You know, are you okay? What's wrong, Pastor?" And he said this. He says, "I'm in a hurry, and God is not." Can you relate to that? Well, God is not in a hurry. God doesn't work that way, and it's a good thing, because God has a view and a perspective that we will never have. In fact, he has plans and purposes, forgive me for saying it this way, that are way above our pay grade. Isaiah 55:9 says, "My ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." So the passage that we're going to look at this morning is from Isaiah 40, 28 to 31. You may recognize it right away. I know this is a life verse for so many people. And it really shows the value of waiting, specifically waiting for the Lord. There is no question about it. Waiting is hard. And Isaiah knew a lot about waiting. So I hope you'll turn to your Bible. We're going to look again at Isaiah 40, verses 28 through 31. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. May God bless us with insight and understanding as we strive to apply God's word to our everyday lives. So let me give a little bit of background information. Isaiah was a prophet. Prophets were introduced during the days of Samuel, who was the last of the judges. And the prophet's role was to speak for God. And oftentimes, that meant confronting the people and their leaders with both God's commands and promises. True prophets were usually not popular, and you'll see why. When God called Isaiah to be a prophet, he did not promise him success. In fact, he told them that people would not listen, but he was to continue to speak anyway because eventually some would listen. There would be like a remnant. So as you can see, Isaiah knew about waiting. Isaiah also was one of the prophets who prophesied about the coming of the Messiah. You want to talk about a long wait, and obviously Isaiah would never get to see that prophecy be fulfilled in his lifetime. So Isaiah knew all about waiting, and that's just a little bit background about him. But now let me give you a little bit of context about the book itself. The book of Isaiah has 66 chapters. Chapters 1 through 39 actually carry a message of judgment for sin. God's people were sinning left and right. They were perverting justice. They were oppressing the poor. They had turned from God to idols, and they were worshiping pagan gods. They had forgot, maybe we call it amnesia, but they had forgot that it was the Lord who saved them from slavery in Egypt. And they had rejected the law that God had given to Moses and the people, the law that commanded the people to worship the Lord God and only Him. So as a result, God punished them by allowing their enemies to defeat them and to take them into exile. Chapters 40 and following bring a message of forgiveness and comfort and hope. Now, ultimately, it's a message of hope because of the coming of Messiah, but more currently, if you will, there was hope that the captives will eventually be released from exile and allowed to return home to Jerusalem. And let me just say right here, this is God's mercy, okay? God was very clear. God tells you if you obey, these are the blessings. If you disobey, these are the consequences. So these people are living out the consequences of their disobedience. But here, we're going to see God's mercy at its best. God knew that when these people were released to go back home, it would not be an easy journey. They would have to travel a great distance with their families, young and old, and all their belongings. And what was waiting for them was not a nice, comfortable bed to rest in, but they were going to have the task of having to rebuild their homes. So there was a lot of work ahead of them when they actually were released from exile. God also knew that their exile had been long, that they would be weary and discouraged, and also that the waiting wasn't quite over. And so what does he do? Because he is so loving and merciful, he sends Isaiah to give them this word of comfort and hope in their time of waiting. God knew that they were struggling. And he knew that if they focused inward rather than upward, they might have a pity party and think that God isn't even concerned about them. So God knows it's important that they remember who God is. So before I expound on verses 28 to 31, I want to look at some verses before that because they are a reminder of how amazing the one who is making these promises really is. So listen to verse 25, and this is actually very significant. To whom then will you compare me, that I should be like him, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He's referring to the stars. He who brings out their hosts by number, calling them all by name, by the greatness of his might, and because he is strong in power, not one is missing. Now let me tell you why God is saying this. This would have meant something, because some of the pagans worshipped astrology. And here God is reminding them that he is the one that made the stars. And when he declares that not one of them is missing, he surely will never forget even one of his people, who obviously meant much more to him than the stars. You see, when we remember the greatness of God, then everything else falls into perspective. Someone once defined circumstances as those nasty things that you see when you take your eyes off of the greatness of God. Isaiah also reminds them that the Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He says he doesn't faint or grow weary, and his understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases their strength. You and I are the ones that get tired and exhausted from our circumstances, from our waiting. God does not. And what a wonderful promise. He reminds them then that even though youth and young men get tired, well, of course they get tired. We all get tired, especially when we do things in our own strength or when we try to do things our own way. God's power and strength never diminish. He is never too tired to help us because his strength is our source of strength. Then he gives the most wonderful promise. He says, those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. And can I just tell you, the image here is not of a person waiting with their arms folded, looking at their watch, patting their foot and saying, oh, what is taking so long? No, waiting for the Lord is trusting him, even though you don't know how it's going to turn out, you know he's got it. It's trusting that God is accomplishing something, even though you can't see it, while you're waiting. A biblical story that comes to my mind when I think about this scripture. Moses has delivered the Israelites out of Egypt, out of slavery. Okay, huge miracle. And they are camped right in front of the Red Sea. And it's the time when they realize that, oh boy, the Egyptians have come after us and they're following. And all of a sudden, the Israelites, what do they want to do? They want to go back to Egypt because they feel trapped. They're sure that they're going to drown. And what does Moses say to the people? He says, stand still, are you kidding me? And see the salvation of the Lord. Can you even imagine how difficult it would have been to stand still and wait when this great Egyptian army is right behind them? I mean, they could feel the ground shaking from all their horses. They knew how angry they were, okay? Their entire slave labor has gone. Stand still, are you kidding me? And yet, then what does God do? He parts the Red Sea so that they can go safely on dry land. And what did he do? He removed the obstacle. And here's the thing. There are times in our lives when we pray and God does in fact remove the obstacle and the difficulty. But honestly, I think more often than not, he doesn't remove it because he's calling us to trust him and to wait for him. Some of you may have heard of Johnny Erickson Tata. She was a woman who years and years ago experienced a very tragic diving accident and she was paralyzed. Now, there's no question in my mind that she had people everywhere, including herself, praying for healing. Well, God did not heal her, but what he did was he gave her his strength, and he used her mightily and continues to use her to be an instrument of grace and faith. She has ministered to so many people with disabilities through her ministry called Johnny and Friends, but also through her painting using her mouth to show God's strength made perfect in weakness. You can be sure that the people in Isaiah's day would love for God to have removed the obstacle, right? To have ended the exile right there, to have made the journey back home easy, and to have had everything just the way it used to be. But no, because God's plan was to get them to trust him and to worship him and only him. So Isaiah's words were so important. Those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. Now let me just ask you, do you remember the last time, or maybe you're doing it now, maybe you have a youngster at home, remember the last time you tried to dress a little child? And how many times did you have to say, stand still, just stand still, wait? Well, I wonder if that's what God kind of experienced with us, right? He promises to give us his strength if we wait for him. But if we just keep fidgeting and moving around or trying to resolve our own problems in our own strength, in our own ways, we're not going to get his strength. And we are going to grow weary. Because to wait for the Lord means to let God be God. Let God do it his way, and he will renew our strength. You know, I think there's a better translation for the word renew, a more accurate translation, and it is actually the word exchange. And I want to just share with you a little illustration that I think will make more sense. Years ago, I used to drive a van, and one night I forgot to lock it, and Fred had a set of my keys in his pocket, and he was wrestling with our children. They were having a great time. And the button that opens the side door to my van got pressed unbeknownst to us. And of course, the next day, my battery was dead. Well, this was probably the third or fourth time that my battery had died. So it needed more than a little charge. It needed an exchange of a new battery. And I think life is like that. Sometimes we just need a charge, kind of a renewal, but there's other times when we actually need an exchange. And God offers an exchange of our weariness for his strength. And I think that's a pretty good deal. So what else happens when we wait for the Lord? Isaiah says, we mount up with wings like eagles. Is that the most beautiful picture of God helping us rise above our problems and soaring over them, giving us a different, a higher, maybe a more heavenly perspective? And what a great comparison with the eagle. Only a few birds like the eagle are capable of soaring. Their wings are so strong that they catch the current, and without moving a feather, they can soar up to incredible lengths, heights. Some eagles have actually been clocked at up to 80 miles per hour without flapping their wings at all. They just soar on the invisible columns of air. And you know what else they do? They actually look for the storms, and they fly straight into them, and they use the weather to help lift them to even greater heights. And think about this with you and I. I don't know about you, but I do not run. I don't run to storms. I don't run into difficulties. I avoid them. I want to run away. But isn't it the storms of life that help us to grow? That's an awesome promise. So to be able to soar in his strength, to be able to soar high above our circumstances and maybe even welcome the storms, praise him in the storm, thank him for the storms, because he's giving us his strength in the storms. So what else does Isaiah say about waiting on the Lord? He says, those who wait on the Lord shall run and not be weary. And I don't know about you, but that sounds pretty good to me. And haven't you experienced that? Where you were, I don't care, something going on in your life and you're exhausted and you're weary and I don't know how I'm going to get through this day, but you waited for the Lord and somehow at the end of the day, it's like, wow, I had the energy. I was able to run. I was able to accomplish what I needed to do. And why are we surprised? Why are we surprised? God's word, God's promise. He is a promise keeper. Finally, he promises those who wait for the Lord shall walk and not faint. Now, maybe you've had that experience. This is kind of even another level of circumstances and difficulties where you just feel like, oh, you're just going to, that feeling of faint or just not going to be able to handle it. And yet you wait on the Lord, and what does he do? He enables you to just walk through it. You might not be soaring, you may not be running, but you know what? He enabled you to walk through it, and that was all that you needed. I don't know where you are at today, but I'm going to venture a guess that you're waiting on something. I'm pretty sure we're all waiting for or on something. And can I just lovingly say to you, if you are really struggling in the waiting, maybe you're feeling like you're just like that little boy, like you're just drowning those worms. Maybe you feel like nothing is happening and nothing is going to happen. Then the message that Isaiah shared with God's people is a message for you. Because waiting is not a waste of time. I want to close with you because I think it's helpful to hear this in a different perspective. I want to read to you this same passage, only from a different translation, so that you can hear it in a fresh way. And it's from the Message translation. Don't you know anything? Haven't you been listening? God doesn't come and go. God lasts. He's the creator of all you can see or imagine. He doesn't get tired, doesn't pause to catch his breath, and he knows everything inside and out. He energizes those who get tired, gives fresh strength to dropouts, for even young people tire and drop out. Young folk in their prime stumble and fall, but those who wait upon God get fresh strength. They spread their wings and soar like eagles. They run and don't get tired. They walk and don't lag behind. Waiting is not a waste of time when we wait for the Lord, because he has an endless supply of fresh strength. Let us pray. Father God, whatever we may be waiting for, waiting on, whatever struggles we're going through, God, I pray that this beautiful passage from Isaiah would give us encouragement and give us hope. And know that our waiting is never wasted when we wait for you, when we wait on you. And that, God, you are always accomplishing something in it. And, God, I think about that wonderful exchange that we can give you our weariness and you will exchange it for your strength. God, I again pray that this verse would become maybe a life verse, or at the very least, that it would come to our mind this week when we're struggling in the waiting. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And now may the love of God, our Creator, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide with you now and forevermore. Go in peace and have a wonderful week. Amen. For family.
This world.